CAMPO, a space to debate, study and celebrate architecture.
Allora, intanto buonasera. lui è Giovanni Tani, viene da Amman, in Giordania. In questo momento sta a Bari da qualche giorno, sta organizzando, curando una mossa insieme a Antonio Manelli, che è lì dietro, e che poi interverrà nella discussione. Giovanni dirige ad Amman un centro di ricerca che si chiama Studio-X Amman. Studio-X è un centro di ricerca sull'architettura urbanistica diretto, fa capo alla University, e ha 5 sedi in tutto il mondo, e una di queste è Amman, che si è aperta nel 2009. Tuad dirige da circa 2013-2014 con Nora Kauli, e circa da quell'anno, dal 2015, diciamo, ha sviluppato un progetto di ricerca multidisciplinare sulla città di Amman insieme ad Antonio, attraverso una serie di workshop con studenti che vengono invitati attraverso un open call da tutto il mondo, partecipano, e con vari gradi di istruzione, se non mi sbaglio, poi vi racconterò meglio lui. Loro hanno fatto una ricerca sulla città utilizzando diversi mezzi, dalla fotografia al video, per fare una mappatura e studiare il modo in cui è cresciuta e si è sviluppata la città dal 45 all'incirca ad oggi, e si è sviluppata enormemente, perché immaginate che parte da un numero di circa 150.000 abitanti per arrivare ai 2 milioni attuali, 4 milioni attuali. E hanno fatto un lavoro su hanno utilizzato alcuni luoghi, diciamo, della città come case studio, per studiare in generale lo sviluppo delle città del mondo arabo, ma anche sono dei casi per fare anche delle relazioni con le metropoli internazionali, quindi non soltanto arabe. In particolare sono focalizzate su alcune zone in cui ci sono una serie massiccia, diciamo, di edifici abbandonati, quindi studiando in qualche modo la relazione tra questi edifici e il modo in cui il motivo per cui questi edifici poi sono stati abbandonati è un modo per guardare anche al futuro della città. Però adesso penso che lui lo spiegherà sicuramente meglio di me. E Giovanni è qui perché il 24 febbraio aprirà una mostra che si chiama Frozen Imaginaries, che è il titolo, diciamo, di tutto il lavoro del workshop, che pure è insieme a Antonio Manelli, in cui presentano il lavoro, che è un lavoro fatto corale, fatto da diretto da Antonio Manelli e Giovanni insieme agli studenti. Il 24 febbraio apre questa nuova galleria, si chiama Planar, che è una galleria, un centro di ricerca che già esiste a Bari da Dani? Antonio? Vai Dani,
sì, iniziamo sì, 2 anni fa.
Che è un laboratorio, un centro di ricerca e anche una casa editrice, e ora aprirà un nuovo espositivo proprio il 24 febbraio con questa mostra, poi vi spiegheranno meglio, insomma, ora lascio.
First of all, thank you, Gianmarco, thank you, Emilia, for having me here. I want to apologize, I don't know how to speak in Italian, I wish I can, but feel free to kind of stop me during anything I'm saying, if you want me to repeat, or maybe, and feel free to open the conversation if you have any questions. Maybe you can turn off the lights. As Emilio was saying briefly, Studio-X Amman is a research platform. It's run by the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation at Columbia University in New York. It's part of 500 Studio-X's. We work together in different parts of the world, like Mumbai, Beijing, Rio, Johannesburg, and then together we kind of form this global network of understanding cities, and we kind of develop programs in terms of a series of lectures conferences and design studios and seminars. So, for instance, this is one of our programs. It's called the X Talk series. It's similar to this, where you have kind of a conversation, more intimate conversation with audiences and researchers and practitioners. And Amman, it's called Studio-X Amman. This is map of the Arab Peninsula. You have Amman, Syria, Jordan, etc. So it shows it's not just about only Amman. It's a more of a regional platform where we've done lots of work with Istanbul, with Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Beirut, Cairo. So we have several collaborators, and we work as a hub to kind of identify and kind of curate programs with institutions in Amman, Jordan, and in the Arab world. So we are briefly showing you some of the work that we kind of produce at Studio-X. Then we go to Frozen Imaginaries. This is part of a workshop that we started in 2014. It's called the Echoing Borders. It was investigating refugees and basically mapping narratives. So it was not about thinking in terms of design solutions or designing, let's say, settlements or designing cities. It was about mapping and narrating what happens within with the refugees. This, for instance, it's a map. I'm sorry, did not show as well here, but this is a study from a satellite image. Every dot you have is a settlement, a refugee settlement. This is on the north border of Jordan and Syria. So through satellite images, you will understand how settlements of refugees, they stay in no man's land between Syria and Jordan. So through that, you can understand how those kind of informal settlements are born, come to life. So this is on the east. This is the border control with the army. So what used to happen, some refugees get smuggled, etc. So it was mapping this kind of a process rather than understanding, physically understanding the narration of this process. Again, this is part of the same logic, where this is a refugee camp. It's in the north of Jordan, one of the largest refugee camps in Amman. It's a Syrian refugee camp. So one of the students, Time, Juan Pablo, he was understanding the border of the refugee camp, understanding the porosity. What kind of activity happens, how people get smuggled in, what gets smuggled out, and understanding the economy of the refugee camp itself, rather than physically. Again, those are different examples of, again, different manifestations of mapping, rather again, than design something. What you design is our numbers, our stories, etc., and you frame them in a way to kind of present them and then show what is something that is intangible. Again, so several examples. Another program would be Genetic Global Library. Those books we have at our space, we got them from an urban sociologist. She's one of the most well-known Arabic urban sociologists. She taught at the University of Chicago, and unfortunately, 3 years she passed away, and her daughter, Leila, she donated the books. So what we're now developing is a seminar around those books, most of them related on Arab cities. So at Studio-X Amman, we developed a seminar around those books where those books are now connected through a virtual library network around the Arab world. This is one project we're working on. And through those meetings that we have, we're hopefully, by the end of April, this will be activated through this network and all the material will be available online, and we activate this network of books, of hidden books. We have amazing libraries that are hidden within, honestly, the Arab world. For instance, in Jordan, you don't have a national library where you can have a reference. So this is kind of a project to jumpstart this kind of a network. Today, I'll be coming back to this project. It's called Frozen Imaginaries. It's investigating different landscapes of abandonment and what does abandonment mean. We started out as mapping those abandoned buildings, and later on, I will move forward how we use different kind of methods and different data and how we interpret it to produce a manifestation of wondering, asking ourselves what is abandonment. abandoned exactly how can it be utilized. Again, those are the several kind of exercises we did, and now another program which is called P1, Propositions 1. This one, Antonio came to Amman, he was part of it. It was in a symposium, a conference about research-based practices. So again, the role the architect plays in it, not just physically building, but again, the research-based practices and how they affect our society and how they kind of steer the realm of architecture. And so through pedagogy and through teaching, like what we are trying to do, let's say at Columbia or at the Studio-X Amman, and how this kind of find its way into the architecture profession. Another program would be cities and films. So we worked with Rasha Sati. She's a film curator at Toronto Film Festival to create a series of films about cities. Many of them are in the Arab world, but we invited the architects and the directors, and we had this program, 3-day program about film and architecture. So now I'm going to Frozen Imaginaries. Frozen Imaginaries, it's a project started out of curiosity, I would say. Any architect walking around the city, you would find some abandoned buildings. Architects would see such buildings as opportunities to intervene, to make change, etc. So at the beginning, it started just for me. My friend is a photographer, his name is Sam Demon, and he has a piece. We went and we started kind of taking photos of those different landscapes of abandonment that are inside the city, in the middle of the city. So it started just kind of a pinpointing, a geolocation, pinpointing them on a map and understanding where they are and why they are here. And the next thing was interesting that there were different, kind of like the two towers, for instance, here. You had different scales of abandonment in different areas in the city. So the question for us started is, why this mutation in scale and size and in pattern of abandonment and how it happened? Those two towers were situated in one of the highest places in Amman, so they're visible everywhere, and they were built on a public park. It was a public park where, let's say, in the middle of this residential neighborhood, and what the municipality did is that they offered this public park for investors from the Gulf. So the investor from the Gulf, they took on the park and they started doing those huge buildings in the middle of a residential neighborhood. So along the way, everything stopped because of economic crisis, because of lack of infrastructure, and I'll be talking more about this project in specific. This is more, this is Amman in 1946. Unfortunately, all the information here won't be short enough, I'll be talking about it. So in 1946 was the establishment of the independence of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. At the time, this spot became the capital of the newly formed Hashemite Kingdom. It was a village. It was a village in Circassian village who are refugees. They were refugees, Circassian refugees. Circassians, they come from southwest Russia, which is on the Black Sea, let's say near Georgia, next to Georgia and Chechnya. So this was just a village where at that time 30% of the people lived in tents and caves in 1946. And by 1952, another one also. Again, I apologize, this is a timeline of events where we're showing a series of events of what was happening around the city. So for us, it was interesting to kind of relate through abandoned buildings, understand when they appeared and why they appeared. What happened is after 2 years of the independence of Jordan, there was a war, the Arab-Israeli war. Israel occupied Palestine, and now we have the state of Israel. So you had the first wave of refugees who came from Israel, which is Palestine, who came from here and from the west. So at the time, what happened in 1952, the population in Jordan grew from 182,000 to almost 800,000. So you had a huge wave of refugees coming into the city. So next one. So now you can see how the city kind of started spreading.
So because of that, planning was used as a tool to introduce kind of modernization, a solution to produce economic and political stability. So in 1955, the first planners were assigned to kind of design a plan for the city. They were British planners. Before the independence of Jordan, Jordan was a British protectorate under the British mandate. So consequently, you had British planners coming and designing the city. What was interesting about it is that one of the comments they made is that for them, Amman was all made of open space because it was a small village at the time. But they tried to introduce a park, which they called the Central Park, in the middle of the valleys of Amman. Amman is made up on seven hills surrounding this block. And inside in the middle, we have the valley, which was essential in terms of, for our work at least, and how we try to develop it. It became a reference point. Because it, again, this tool of planning and kind of introducing the solution, and we traced that and how this was affected throughout the city. And we, you know, with that, what happened is different typologies of buildings that affected the urban fabric of the city. The first were the refugee camps. Refugee camps were essential at the time because they were tents. And they made 30% of people living in the city of Amman. So the refugee camps were, sorry, nothing appears here, but the dots kind of show where they are situated within the city center, let's say downtown Amman. But by doing so, the city was experiencing a surge of growth that is not controllable. So busy rules and regulations, etc., went unregulated, and the growth went viral. We can look at it. So, in the 70s, almost 70s and 80s, this is what happened. Amman was sporadically kind of growing. And here, the government tried to kind of control this housing need, because it was always housing, economy, and public space, whatever public space is, and what they mentioned it. But so they started developing those housing projects through governmental housing projects, but not like social housing projects, kind of but something that roams between a socially kind of a needed community and a housing project as around the city. But again, none of this kind of affected the urban fabric of the city. And then what happened is that at the time, after the 80s, late 70s and 80s, in the late 70s you had a Black September War, which is the Jordanian army against the PLO, Palestinian Liberation Organization. And those series of events, Amman became a place where the battle was taken between those different, let's say, the armies. And what happened is the refugee camps took on a different role of kind of being the base for the Palestinian, the PLO, they call them the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization. And the city, again, with all of this, it was still experiencing growth because more refugees are coming now. If you move forward, Tony, again, presenting. So this slide was representing kind of the population growth. In 1946, this in 2010 only, it reached 5.6 million almost. And now, in 2015, in 2017, the population of Jordan became 10 million, the population of Amman 4 million, starting from almost 33,000 to 4 million. And what happens is in the 80s, the municipality, the greater Amman municipality, they said we want to develop a greater comprehensive plan, Canada, to control this growth. The solution was, one of the main solutions, I can't see the solution was, but one of the main kind of proposals was to extend the borders of Amman, kind of to develop this envelope again, the Tulu extension. This would be seen as using the city as a platform for opening up design opportunities or investments. So anything that's designed is an investment. So anyway, attracting, they were trying to attract more investors to do that. And this came to its highest peak in 2000. In 2003, after the US invasion of Iraq, So the US came to, this is clear. So in 2003, the US came to the vacuum. Everybody knows the story, what happened. You had, at the beginning, you had 300,000 refugees came to Amman from Iraq. I refrain from saying refugees because they were investors. They were investors with money. And by doing so, they came to Amman. And they started investing, and the market went back on. But what happened is that the real estate prices went 400%. With this kind of a high value, even though the city was even growing more and more. Then the municipality, what they said, we want to develop this vision to become metropolitan Amman, the metropolitan growth of Amman. We want to be like Dubai, we want to be like Milan, we want to be like an international hub. So they started investing, attracting investors towards Jordan. So after the 2003 war in Iraq, we started seeing different kind of scale of buildings. We started seeing towers. Towers are the new thing to do. We should build towers. And they started doing that. And what was interesting is that they used the open space, which at the beginning in the middle, which was a central part for the planners, now transformed into an asset opportunity in the middle of neighborhoods to attract investors. And they started by doing that. We kind of call it Dubai syndrome. Is doing what Dubai is doing. Because the model for Dubai was working so well, the whole Arab countries want to do the same. Fortunately, in 2008, the economic crisis or global crisis, well, it was the US crisis, but they managed to spread it all away, came, and most of these projects stopped. And now there's specific sites in Jordan, kind of taken for granted, not complete, showing the city's unrealized vision of itself. And each every year, each and every time, the city was kind of trying to perform to reach a certain point, but maybe what was not really taken into consideration that we've read in the asset plans was planning is a kind of a set of policies and rules and regulations. And most of the plans, they were referring to planning as something that you do not take into consideration politically and out of conditions. And all of the politics and wars and economic conditions shaped for Amman to become what it was. So, what I did in the beginning is I said, okay, I invited the students and architects just for 4 days. I said, we have different scales of abandonment. Those are the abandoned towers. So I told them, let's just investigate kind of tactics. Introducing tactics rather than design solutions. And the point was for us not to design a public space. So in reality, sorry, I didn't put the image. This is all blocked. All towers, you have a huge podium, 4-story high podium, then you have the tower. So the solution was for the participants is that let us keep this unfinished. If an investor comes and put money in it, let them do that. But the point was for them is that let's talk about the ground floor and about what does this relationship mean. Again, they were kind of thinking about the tactic. So they developed those images, and because at the beginning, if you see a huge tower that's empty, again, design solutions come to you. Let's do a public park. Let's do a vertical farming project. Bam, bam, bam. But for us, it was not just about showing a solution. It was about understanding how this kind of different form of landscape of abandonment came to life. So what we did then, I contacted Antonio. I told Antonio, I started doing this project and let's develop something out of it. So me and Antonio, we started doing what we first did is, we looked at all of the master plans that were done in Amman. This was the first document and it shows any traces of planning for Amman, which was in 1955. And what was interesting, that even the municipality in Amman, they do not have this file. It's only found in England. I found it in England, in the UK, in an archive in a university, but not in Amman. The same goes for the 60s, they don't have it. The 70s, I found it through a French researcher at the French Institute. So, looking at the city, it won't show here. You had seven hills where the city was kind of formed. And the valley is where the refugees at the beginning settled, because there's water. Wherever there's a valley, there's again water being collected. And for the architects here, it was they were trying to introduce a form of public space, and then he used the architect called Central Park. And we found an interesting article done by Professor Jordan for Persisting Vision. He went through the documents about Hilly, and he said his argument was those master plans become persisting towards reaching one thing, which is public space, housing, and the economy, which usually most plans do that. So we started looking at the document, and the document in the 50s, for example, this is just one plan, showing one hill and another hill, how it can be connected through a bridge. So for the infrastructure solutions were part of developing the city, but if you look at that from a different way, any infrastructure project at that time, even now in our land, we didn't have kind of the means to construct this. So Amman was used as a market to invest. Again, investment opportunities started in the 50s. Again, going through kind of the specific statements within the plans of the original master plans. What we eventually did at this part, Antonio and I kind of, after going through those plans, we pinpointed specific points on the five plans that are shared between each other. For us now, Amman, if you open Google and you search Amman, you have images of this topography and those buildings on top of it. In a way, like how Matera is made of stone, a city of stone. But if you look closer there at Amman, you'll find that there are lots of abandoned buildings in different scales within the city, in different parts of the city. So we started going there at night, setting up different cameras, and at night, you won't see anything active. You would see a street, some buildings that are active, but then you start seeing the abandonment. And for instance, those two towers, you pass them by day, they're almost finished. You think that it's active, it's working, but it's not. The same goes as this building. This building is super interesting. It's called the Living Wall. It was designed by Norman Foster. Unfortunately, it stopped. The one on the top left, this is what's left of the Central Park. It's just a small park underneath the downtown area, and it's completely, nobody uses it because you can't even see it. Like, have people living in Amman, they don't know that it's there. It's like the area outside. So each and every scene relates to a specific part of the master plan, discussing the vision of the master plan. So, with that, this is the Central Park I was talking about. If you Google Amman, you'll see this. That's a building and active. But the Central Park should have started at this point down here. Well, referring to what was said, it was an open space that kind of introduced civic spaces and cultural spaces, introduced museums, promenades, markets in terms of like a fish market, I don't know. Say it in English. So again, with those points, Antonio and I went with the participants and who are architects and architecture students, we went on this way of kind of documenting Amman. Amman, which was once a village, can we start with this here? Which was once a village, the downtown valley was here, downtown Amman. So this is supposed to be the central park. But in the 2000s, the municipality came and said, we're gonna reintroduce this public space. They built huge headquarters for them, a theater space and a kind of cultural space, introducing culture through a theater. Open plazas. The scale of the plaza is huge. We never had the scale of open space in Amman as a designed open space. And they took over the valley, which is right down this picture. It was interesting, can we go back to that? The growth of the city, yeah. The growth of the city was growing at a really fast pace that not even infrastructure was keeping pace. The sidewalks are being built. You just have a street and then buildings will come up. People were building. And the population was growing because of the series of events that's happening. So for us it was important to kind of understand why this mountain is full with abandoned buildings. Why then? No, can we go to the next one? Then, this is going to the west of Amman from the downtown. Construction started growing more and more and more. And we start seeing traces of heights. Amman is all four stories. We never had huge buildings. But now, with the vision of pushing Amman towards future expansion and kind of growing more, again, they want investors. This is what is being advertised as the new downtown of Amman. So, it's interesting that most of our countries, when you see a tower, it means that you're progressing, it means that you're moving towards a better economical situation. And we always relate it to the West, like the West. The West is the right way, the West is the right way. And by the West, it's more of a US, let's say, the US. And then instead what we have is kind of a completely different than the West. It's kind of something that mutated. It's not like you're going downtown Toronto or downtown New York or those metropolitan London cities. But again, even in this space, all of the upper floors are still vacant. Nobody's using them because they're super expensive. This project stopped due to the economic crisis, but it continued because the government, they needed someone to keep the investment. And the pictures like this was, this is at the outskirts of the city. In an area in the 60s, Amman, surrounding this village of Amman, in order to control this growth, they proposed, let's do an agricultural event. All of the land is supposed to be agriculture. And in the 60s, 60% of the people in Amman, they relied on agriculture in terms of income generation. But now, going to the south part of Amman, and the southwest part of Amman, you can see traces of buildings coming. This is almost standing at the border of the greater Amman municipality area. This was Antonio. For him, it was interesting is that this is at the southern tip border of Amman. If you're looking now, as if you're looking north, you're looking towards the city growing towards you. And I think in 15 years, maybe, or 10 years, the buildings will reach. And again, we still have the same problem of this uncontrollable growth. But what was interesting for us is abandonment, because the abandoned buildings were the trace of this kind of mutation of growth, of planning. So, big problem what we did a month ago, almost a month ago. Again, we started in the city from a master plan, then we went into a building, and then we went into the building and understood the life that's surrounding this building itself. So through different methods of visual investigation, what we did is we focused on the building itself, the building that usually is taken for granted. It's there, but you never think about it. We pass by abandoned buildings each and every day, but we never look what's happening around them. This guy, Abu Rabia, his name is Abu Rabia. He works right in front of the Central Park. So he works in front of the proposal that the Greater Amman Municipality did in 2000. In the 50s, this should have been an open kind of organic space, but in 2000, in the early 2000s, they developed this new gated plaza in front of the Roman Empire. And what happened is that people did not start coming to this area because we're not used to this kind of scale of public open space. So it was difficult to locate someone who lives right near the valley. All the people who work in the downtown valley, they do not live there. One thing is difficult to go there by your car, the traffic is insane. It's not the best place to kind of commute back and forth every day. So people usually live far away. If they still have someone to do, they do their work. So Abu Rabia was interesting because he was living right behind his place. 40 steps, as he mentioned. It just takes him 40 steps to reach his place and come back. And he lives between abandoned buildings and inside of an abandoned vision. So participants worked with the Antonio, kind of a developing methodology of following him, kind of developed this kind of narration through video. This is the Norman Foster project, the living one. So we entered inside, and there's life inside. Some people kind of are related to the building. You have dogs, you have dogs still working there, that they stay at the site. And what we realized is that because the building was built on the cliff, and they cut the cliff, they did this kind of quarry. Now, most of the people living on top, what happened is they were moved out of their houses by the company. The company put them in hotels until they finished the project. The project did not finish. And the problem is that the mountain is falling. Then we realized that there is still some life going inside within this building itself. So it was a matter of jumping scales, of understanding the different scales of abandonment, and how did abandonment start with a small house near to the central park, then because of the second master plan became a big deal, but then the third and the fourth master plan transformed it into a neighborhood, and the fifth master plan transformed it into towers and the woods inside the town. So for us, the abandoned building was kind of used as a tool, as a device, not as a for design purposes, rather a device to look back into the city and to try to narrate the city of what's happening. Because most cities in the world, they have abandoned buildings in downtown areas, I guess. I've been to Rio de Janeiro, it's full of wood inside. Even in Spain, because of the Madrid, because of the economic crisis, you have lots of abandoned buildings on the periphery of the city. So, in a way, for Antonio and I, the way we're kind of pushing it forward is we are living in the landscapes of the future cities, which is abandonment. Abandonment is surrounding us, but it's something not taken into consideration. One way of doing it is redesigning this, plus understanding how they work as a network and what do they represent. Because they were kind of the only witness that seen this change within the city. And again, this is a little bit dramatic, I chose it because this is inside a building. It's called Mega Mall. It's a mega mall. It's super huge mall. It's like 30 times bigger than the biggest project in Jordan. It was being built. What was interesting, it was a huge compound that it contained all of the elements of the city. It contained an amphitheater. They were building a river on the roof. It was like a half a kilometer river. The bridge became for them to connect mountains through rivers. And when there was a river on top, they had a completely different vision. So through the video, we kind of narrated different scenes of this building, but telling the narration of the city itself. Back to this picture, which I find really interesting, because if you think that now that Amman was a village less than 100 years ago, and now it's developing to that, and this is just a small portion of what Amman is. Amman became 4 million. You see 4 million in a city that does, we have zero resources. We are the third poorest country when it comes to water. In terms of economy and export, agricultural land is almost overdone. So the city is still looked as a platform for investments. But even these investments kind of failed us after the economic crisis. But when this picture, if it was in a clear resolution, you see that all of this strip is left abandoned. All of this strip is left abandoned. Lots of different strips within the city are completely destroyed. Because of negligence, because people were moving. It's not like coming from rural areas, moving the city. It was the opposite, moving out. And Greater Amman Municipality, the way they promote their development plans for the city center. Recently, the last plan was called the Cultural Corridor. So inside the valley, inside here, we do have a Roman Imperium. We have a citadel, the Valkyrie temple from the Roman rulers. We we have an amphitheater, Roman Empire. So those traces of ruins of Roman culture. Even before that, down the line, we have ruins that date 7,500 BC. It's an area called Ain Ghazal, which is Ain means eye of water, basically. And what the municipality is doing, they're pumping money to preserve this amphitheater and the citadel, but all around them, they have a city around it. The city is completely, not completely, but a major part of the city is being abandoned. So tracing this pattern of abandonment, we understood that the city is abandoning itself and it's growing too fast. Okay, it's not economy, not architects or planners are kind of coping with it. And now with kind of recent events happening in most cities in the world, migration, what's happening with the Syrian migration now, what's in Europe, they're discussing about borders, about closing borders. And a man doing that, it started on refugees. It began on refugees. 2 million Syrian refugees you have almost in Jordan. 1.6 is 2 million. The numbers are different because some refugees are registered, some are not. So, well, we in Ontario, Canada, are developing this visual investigation with the students and the architects, is that understanding the tool of planning and anticipating how a city grows, and those kind of documents that are given with policies and statements, how do they perform? And now, with all the materials that we have, we are currently developing an exhibition that Planar will be talking about it more here in Italy on the 24th. And to start raising this argument, to start having this discourse between architects, planners, researchers, cities as usual, but through abandonment. Because abandonment, literally, it is our new landscape, at least for this city. It became part of the fabric of the city. I apologize that I'm not speaking in Italian. I wish I could, but it'd be difficult for me to try to speak Italian. So thank you for listening, and maybe we can have a conversation now, also with Antonio.
Thank you, Edgar. Thank you, Gianfranco. And many of you for joining us. And Frozen Imaginaries research that the ones that you know since 2 years. And so we had a couple of, we had a lot of thoughts, we shared a lot of thoughts in the last 3 years. And I have a couple of questions.
Okay.
First one is really simple and easy. Did you decide when and why you decided to call me and involve me to this research? So, why did you think that photography and actually visual art can be helpful in terms of planning and urbanism and architecture field things?
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, because I think I was trained in most of the environment that I grew up with and trained as architects. We're kind of an architectonic. We're good at analyzing. We're good at extracting information from a plan, from a satellite image, from a drawing. We're used to analyzing space and the body map, you know, do that, this kind of investigation to understand. Like the infograph I showed you. The infograph is the growth of the city that comes from aerial images. So, the way you deal with it in the terms of photography, for me, I find it, which kind of a counter-narrate what the plan is saying. A plan says something in one dimension. A master plan is saying something in one dimension. But photography is kind of producing a counter-argument of what was supposed to happen. So through this investigation,
we start kind of extracting different way of information from a different perspective. And once you have this dialect between a master plan or a hidden satellite image and what's happening here, you enter a different medium of trying to narrate and understand the city. Because imagine, like you were saying, imagine try to design a master plan through photography rather than through doing it on top. So for me, the way you kind of started implementing those devices and putting those devices to the research that has been begun, kind of opened this dialogue that we're having right now, and we're having last year, is that what are the methods and tools we are using right now in order to do a presentation, a representation of a problem. Now what we do is, in the beginning planning, is you present the problem by stating it and showing kind of how much area and specific growth, etc. But this is another way of representation, a representation of the city, not just the plans. So together with the videos, they opened up the discourse, at least for me, and that's what I'm hoping that we will carry on. Because it might sound really simple. So I think it's just a photograph, some may think it's just a plan, but has more meanings of it, because a plan is more authoritative. When a plan is presented by a government, it has politically kind of effect on it. So there is a political vision towards developing a city which is surrounded by work, refugees, economic crisis, etc. So again, it's highly authoritative. Through this investigation, you remove this layer. This is what's happening on real life. By using this second or fourth dimension on the plan, then you start investigating how the plan was working and how this dimension was working. I don't know if I made myself clear, but again, it's simply different perspectives of one thing.
Thank you so much. And the second question is about reception. Okay, so we use photography and videos in order to face and tackle something that is more that is more related to perception, right? So the drawing, the generating series, and or follow it through a cognitive process, okay? A cognitive transformation. But, what I would like to ask you is about cognitive geography and perception. And starting from a wider view. In Europe nowadays, we are facing different kind of problems related to what's going on in the other world, okay? For example, this one is related to immigrants coming. And as you said, as you mentioned before, immigrants are not just an issue affecting the economy, the politics, but you said refugees, immigrants are investors. So going to Amman, was the first time I changed my perception on the issue related to immigrants coming. So it's like a place, which can give you a global and different view on global issues that are connecting each other related to phenomena that we share. Connecting each other. So, can you go? Can you explain better which situation Jordan faced during the last 50 years, and especially about immigrants, and which role is which role Jordan is running into the other world right now?
Which role?
Jordan,
is talking about, let's say, if I understand your question, Bari, is that
try to give a timeline about the relationship between a city or country and immigration and refugees, etc. How this kind of affected the city. Basically, it was founded on refugees and migrants, because at the beginning, the first settlers of the city were refugees or Circassians, like my family, and in 1864, before there was war, it was part of the Holy Land. So it was founded on this kind of migration, wave of migration. So the Circassians, before it became a village, a small village, and then it happened with the Ottomans, under the Ottoman Empire, they did the railway, and then it became a hub, which is connected from the north by Damascus, from the west by Jerusalem, from the south by the holy city of Mecca, which is a good pilgrimage, which paved the way for migrants to come. You had Syrian migrants at the time coming as merchants to invest, again, to start opening up businesses. The first impact on the room, most impact that affected the growth of the city in terms of not, it's wrong to use the word affected, more of a push the growth of the city, was the occupation of Palestine by Israel. You had the Palestinian refugees coming to the city. But at the time, Amman did not have the capacity nor the infrastructure to have no economy to house refugees. But then we used the term refugees. It's, although they are from the same countries, all of this area is connected with Jerusalem, and even from the south, cities from Jordan, it's connected, part of the same area. But the term refugees is used because if you do not say refugee, it means you lost your land. A refugee means I'm coming back. That's the thing. But that was important, and then kind of started doing the political game in the city. So the migrant, not just as an investor, but also in 1948 in the 50s, it had a heightened layer of how it formed the city. So the city cognitively was cut in half, east and west. East would be where the refugee camps are, Palestinian refugees, and west were Jordanians, were Circassians, Syrian migrants, Jordanian wives. So this is one trace of kind of affecting the city. Later on, another refugee migration will come. But with refugee migration, you have aid. Now European Union, they give somebody, but at the time, like now, for instance, yes, we accept, let's say, X amount of refugees, but we need aid, we need to help us. This started in the 50s. So the city was saying, you need to give us money to start developing the city. Start developing the city that I'm selecting. And it came in the 60s. The US, the United States, they put in a lot of money in Amman to invest infrastructurally and through military. So the issue of refugee or that, it's super kind of intertwined and intertangled between each other. The one thing in the middle that we can put was this building, which showed us a lot of things. With Iran, we had the Iraqi investors and refugees, but again, they work with them investments, investors that affect the city in a different way, completely different way. For us, Amman, you're saying 4 million, but for me, I think Amman is small. In my mind, Amman is really small. Everybody still knows everybody, but I don't think so. We stay the same for at least in 10 years. But the city was kind of fragmented in a way because you deal with your own part of the city. I use specific part of the city. And for me, Amman is small. Amman is really small. But Amman is growing too fast. And more kind of districts are opening. From 7 hills, now it's 21 districts. I'm not sure if it's still 21 districts anymore. I remember it was 21 districts. But again, the term of migration and how it shifted the physical fabric of the city was why the city was being there. It was not something that affected the city, but it is the city. The city became itself because of this. It's not like I have a developed country and it's bad. And I think you affected one district in, you know, the future of Paris, and it's a functioning platform. And you have refugees, and refugees, yes, they will have an effect on a specific part of the city. But this made the city migration, if you kind of abstract it, made the city what it was, what it is.
And what about, how do you think that architecture, planning, and urbanism can affect the quality and geopolitics?
Well, again, planning for us to improve the plans, or at least for me, it was always a tool, to move around the city. It's not just about anticipating the city. It was transforming how the city was perceived. At the beginning, it was perceived as a ceremonial platform, where you have parades, you have public space.
Colonialism.
Yes, colonialism, and then moving towards establishment control. The open space, when you have an open space, a promenade, it means some activities would be here, which means the authority, we are here. We are here. You know, we're holding the city together. But then it becomes a central business district. Try and push it to central business district, which means we want money. So the city became a playground to attract investments, to bring money. So it shifts, this kind of a shift of vision every 10 years or less, shift the overall anticipation of how the city will perform. I'm not in a position to say planning is good, planning is bad, there are lots of things about planning I don't know, but from what I've seen, based on the schemes that were put in the city, I saw the city kind of shifting from one end to another. Rather than having one depth or a concrete base.
A sort of a formal.
Yes. So this is what it does. In terms of architects, architects for them, it's a double-edged sword. Changing the plan means we need to build. We need architects to build. The central business district, etc. Let's do it. Planners, and I, at the time we didn't have any. First planners, we started seeing a man in the 60s. Before that, it was all the US and the British. So even planning, in terms of planning, for us, it's something relatively new in terms of designing the city. The first plan that was done by Arab Jordanian firm was in the 85. Then came another plan. So it's kind of still a method of testing. It's not testing, it's like trying to keep up with this road.
I don't know if you...
I would like to know something more about the condition of the Palestinian, because you said that the first wave of immigrants from Palestine was almost 70 years ago.
Yes.
So my question is, are still they refugees? And how do they perceive the city? Because maybe one of the reasons, because his growth was complicated, was because these people was getting expecting to go back. So do these people live out of the field to be belong to this place?
That's a really interesting long conversation that we can have for hours. But I'll tell you, the term refugee, you never lose the term refugee, because if you, I do not say a Palestinian refugee, you know. Jordanian Palestinian, you know, Palestinian. If I'm living in the same city since we were born, and even before, families between, like, this is Amman, Damascus is right behind you, you know. So this open place was already there. But you never lose the term refugee, because once you drop the term refugee, you drop your life of going back.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just about Palestinian, about me. I do not say I do not drop the Palestinian refugees, because it means there's no Palestine anymore. It's a really tricky situation. And in terms of physical condition, the refugee camps were built right around the city center, at the time at the periphery, at the outskirts of the city. But now they are in the middle of the city. And it's a neighborhood, it's not a refugee camp, but we still use the term refugee, because you do not call it a refugee, but a refugee camp area. They have their own football club, It's one of the best football clubs in Europe. It's not about that, it's a neighborhood. It's part of the city. It's, what is the city? You know? It's called Wahdat. Wahdat means units, because it was done in units. So the units in the neighborhood. That's how we have. Maybe 10 camps in Jordan in general, there are some refugees. But also, of course, this kind of developed system belonging. What is belonging exactly? And I'm living here, but my family is there, etc. You know, the term belonging is something really tricky because it can be used in so many ways to kind of disrupt how a city performs. Even for me, my family comes not originally from Jordan. One of the towers. I have been there. You never forget where you come from. But also, this is the city where you did in all of your life, as your father, as your grandfather, etc. Those are kind of highly political issues that could affect how a city performed. But in terms of how a city performed publicly, the Palestinians, they're smart. The merchants, they know how to produce, they know where. You have the saying, wherever you put a Palestinian, even if you put a Palestinian in the middle of the desert, you will find him in a castle of gold. Why? Because they're smart and developing and doing stuff. They added a lot in terms of economy, in terms of the same goes for each and every migrant. But again, without the refugee, you do not talk without refugee because you dropped your case of going to your home, and because something recent, and you never drop it. But the refugee camps played an important role in how Amman became what it is, in terms of being used as a base for some form of civil war, or whether it is a place with the cognitive map of East and West. East, which was concerned, East, which is in the refugee camp, there's East a little bit. Now it's the center, you know. But it helped a lot in kind of putting this identity of the city, because it was built on migrants at some point. And that's why it was chosen in the middle. You have tried to draw in the north and the south, etc. It was chosen because there was a railway station line that was built by the Ottomans. It put it in a really important position of becoming a major hub of connecting those cities, but also because it was Newton.
What?
Newton. It was not belongs to the north or the south or the east. It was, this is one of them, I think for me at least, one of the reasons why this city, it's interesting to see how it performed. In the maps, you will see aerial photos, tents that you see after 10 years, 15 years, neighborhoods. Now we see it's happening in the north. You have refugee camps that are developing like this. You know how much in a Syrian refugee camp, there is a street, they call it Champs-Élysées. You know how much it costs to rent one caravan there? 15,000 JDs, which is 18,000 euros. You need to rent it, to take it from the owner, and then you pay him rent for the annual rent. Just in 3 years, the economy inside. The turnover, I forgot, I went there a couple of times for some research we were doing. I forgot, but there was a turnover of money in millions that's happening in here.
So it's not controlled. It's not planned.
There was no electricity. Syrian electricians started taking electricity from abroad, and then they couldn't control it. They tell them, we're going to put meters. You're going to start paying. So that's the thing with kind of really fast growth. Things go unplanned. And there's an issue of temporariness. Mm-hmm. Is this a temporary place where the cities are going back?
No.
Or Palestinians are going? So, I'm not the best person to talk about this because lots of research has been done in different ways, and especially now there's a refugee camp, and refugees, Syrian refugees, lots of people are finding it the thing to research. It has been done in Amman years ago, 150 years ago, so. I'm sorry, I don't know if I kind of answered your question, but it's a really topic that is super broad in terms of you need to choose one thing that you can map.
You said that the city is growing very fast and it's expanding all over, and the investors have this interest in outside more than the inside. This is the reason that many of the places inside are being abandoned. And I think this is a problem of the spirit of apartments in the city. Do you have an idea of what is possible to do to attract more, I don't know, what to do with these abandoned places? Is it possible an interaction between public and private, between these investors and the possibility to do also good for public, for the people that are around there? I like the idea that you have worked on the ground floor, and I think it's a good idea, and I wanted to ask, which problems did you find, which problems did you have maybe from political point of view, or what obstacles did you find in your this idea? And I don't know, your idea about how to attract inside of the city, not only expanding. What are the needs of the people that you could say,
One thing I need to explain more, because what I said is a little misleading. After expansion, it's not because the investors investing like magnets and kind of putting this growth. Investors, by the same investors, are related to towers and large scale. Large scale projects were done inside the city. That is the problem. We intensify the city, and places where you can't expand. You have a hill with four-story buildings and you put on this tower. The infrastructure itself is not, does not work. What's really spreading up is private developers, people who construct four-story buildings, residential houses. Those are buying, and it's like a war to buy land to construct.
Because
they're
expensive,
this land.
So, anyway,
but
they...
Now you need to, yeah, it cost you a four-story building, it cost you to build it 1 million euros. Just four stories, 1 million euros. But people are buying, whether they like it or not, okay? People are buying. But the gap between the rich and the poor is becoming so evident. Super evident. And then, in relation to those abandoned buildings and how can they be used, the ground floor is one way of being it. It's a statement, you know, it's a statement about the ground floor and public space rather than the abandoned state of the building. But again, here comes the conversation of design interventions, design physical interventions. But we are now thinking about producing vertical public space, for instance, maybe, because there's no public open space, you can use that. But I think the city, they're not aware of abandoned buildings. That's the thing. For them, it's not a problem. We pass by abandoned buildings every day. That's why the perception of an abandoned building was interesting. You live by abandoned buildings every day. You pass by the two towers every day.
But this is the illness, it's not the life of the city.
No, it's not. Not an illness, but this is a landscape of the city. This is what you see. But us, architects or whatever, we look at it as an opportunity to do that. But also, I'm not saying it's bad, I'm saying this kind of landscape of the city is opening up a new platform. It's like opening up an informal platform for investors, for interaction, for dimensions within the city. And it can be used in hundreds of ways. how to use an abandoned building. But one thing for me is interesting to how would they work as a network? You can introduce a new system of them working together to kind of upgrade the city. But for what I've noticed is that you pass by every day abandoned buildings. They're not a problem, my problem, you know. I pass them by car every day. It's not my problem. But when we did the videos, I will show you one of the videos. You understand that it's a problem for specific people who are living on this scale. And then you raise the question with the municipality, with the planners, with the good. You build an argument, you will start this conversation. There are lots of design solutions for proposals, not solutions for such a problem. And I think this is a problem in itself. Because if they did one public park in one, another public park in one, one large building, they might not work perfectly. But for me, I'm acknowledging those are our cities right now. This is how we're going to keep moving forward. At the end, you're going to have an open air museum of abandonment, you know? A model of abandoned city. We're moving towards that. I'm not, honestly. Just come visit Amman. I'll take you a tour of abandoned buildings. Full. Full, super full. I don't know if I answered your question, but for me, it's part of the city. It's part of the history of the city, the way I see it. But the project was working towards inside the city rather than after expansion. This is the counter narrative I was kind of telling you.
So just one question. In which way this project with so many layers will become an exhibition in 10 days?
In 10 days?
No.
In 7 days.
Yeah. No, okay.
It was interesting. Lots of discussions the past couple of days. Antonio and his team were working with Planside, and Italian architects. Working on designing this exhibition. Because again, those different layers of investigation. The photo is looking from one way, the plan is looking from one way, but each and every one of them is a layer.
Mm-hmm.
It's a layer of narrative perception. So, if those tools of investigation were used to redraw proposition of a plan, what would that mean? You would be drawing a city through statements, through photos, rather than a map. So again, this is the question of how we take this plan for granted, although those are the different layers, are speaking a different language and presenting a different case. So I don't know how it's going to be, but hopefully it will be something, not just the pictures on the wall. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, Giovanni.
CAMPO, a space to debate, study and celebrate architecture.